gives me a great pleasure to introduce Dr. Swarup Sarkar. I remember those old days when I first came to know him. He played a major role when in 1989 he suddenly came up with a finding that IDOs in Manipur are having an explosive epidemic. He was then working in NICED as senior research officer, and I used to work as research officer in Institute of Immunohematology. If you ask me, there are a few gurus that I have. One of them is Swarup Sarkar. He has an entirely different way of looking at a problem, entirely different lateral thinking processes. He tends to come up with different strategies in program. He is basically a product of Banaras Hindu University, where he did his MD. And then he shifted the base from ICMR to UN agencies. It's a proud moment because I don't think from ICMR, excepting Jayanarayan, perhaps people went and made so big. He worked with UNAIDS, he worked with almost every UN agency. He was also part of GFATM. Currently, he is director of communicable diseases in WHO CRO in India. I'm sure when you listen to him, you'll understand different approaches that he is perhaps advocating. I learned that entire piece of advocacy, political advocacy, that you have to do perhaps from him. And the advocacy with masses was Gilada's training. He is one person whose strategies are perhaps important, not only nationally, but internationally. He is acclaimed for the same, and I'm sure you'll understand the same once he starts giving his oration. We thought he was the best candidate for this particular oration. The first oration was given by Dr. Soumya Swaminathan last year, and the next one is with him. Thank you.
Thanks for the kind introduction, and I see many of the old friends and some of the pioneers like Gilada and many other friends I'm meeting after maybe 20 years, you know, 30 years maybe. We're growing old. Now, you see that this is a personal presentation because many of the viewpoints I'll present is not my organization, which is I work for World Health Organization, currently as a director for Southeast Asia for all communicable disease. So that's how it's a personal presentation. I'll be happy to further communicate with you if you want to continue this dialogue. Now, it reminds me of the great warrior, I would say, Suniti Solomon. And as Ganga says, AIDS is about activism. And one disease which had made the history in the world today, and only in 30 years come from diagnosis to ending an elimination strategy because of activism and people like all of you who have relentlessly pursued this cause. Now, I'll talk about four issues. First is ending AIDS is based on, it's not a political slogan, it's based on scientific evidence. But unfortunately, India, unless it's done differently, would miss the target of ending AIDS. And we need to think differently how to do this. And that's how it cannot be more of the same. And what could be the alternate ideas? And lastly, India is in a unique position to start something differently, which could be setting a trend in the world. Now, as you know that the ending or elimination of a disease come from a modeling approach. And the first time in public health, it was used in the malaria, which of course was not successful. But in early 50s, this was a famous McDonald model, which says that the mosquitoes would be there, parasite would be there, but the density would be so low and the reservoir would be so low that the malaria would be withered away naturally. So that's called natural death of a disease, where the reproduction number that one organism gives reproduction of another another parasite in case of malaria would be less than one. That's the basis what when the new antiretroviral regime came and we found out it made people non-infectious, we proposed this. I was a part of director of Global Gap Analysis Division. We proposed a hypothesis of ending HIV by reducing HIV very low in the population. It's not eradication, it's not elimination. It remains so low that disease naturally die. You'd see two slides below. One is the blue color slide. The left one is incidence or new infection. The right one, right blue, was death. So here it shows that starting from now, when we conceptualized this, it was 2014. The global players agreed it for 2015. And we said by 2020, if you could bring down 3/4 of the new infection, 75% reduction of the new infection, you see the infection goes so down that by 2030 it will automatically would not be a public health problem, it would die. That's a basis of this scientific work. And in order to do this, we calculated that we needed a 2/3 reduction of new infection, which is around 66%. So get 66% people virally suppressed, we thought we need 90% people on treatment of those who are tested. So that's how 90% people get tested. 90% of those who become 81% people started treatment, and 90% of those gets virally suppressed, so 70%. So that's the basis, and that's a scientific basis. There has been some literature on this. Now there has been questions on this, but I present South Asian data to validate what I'm saying. You look at the dramatic decline of a Thailand HIV infection. 94, when Thailand started this 100% condom program, their infection was around 170,000, that peak dot, and then you see how it started decline. And in now, over a period of 20 years, the incidence has dropped less than 10%, less than 10,000 now, some 7,000, 8,000, 90% decline. And people who know Thailand, they know that this program was only for 2 years. The program was mainly through the brothel owners to see that clients use condom. Through police, municipality, and the governor's political support, it did not have any involvement. Mostly it was not involving the sex worker themselves. There was no biological program, excepting condom was distributed free. And also there was a mass education of potential client, which reduced young people. And many of you may know that two-thirds of male of 15 to 45 year old in their last year would have visited a sex worker. So this mass media campaign through military owned radio and TV brought down the number of clients, as well as introduced almost more than 90% condom use. And then you see, without any biomedical effort, and after 2 years when almost everything was withdrawn, and I have worked back and forth Thailand from that time to, let us say, 2015, and I have seen that without any further prevention effort, the incidence is going down. This is a real-life demonstration of what we mean by ending AIDS. If you reduce incidence by a program which reduces incidence by 2/3, you will see this decline. So that's a historically validated data. In the meantime, as you know, that our global guideline, WHO global guideline, allows everybody to be treated. And now we think that 37 million people to be targeted for treatment. You also know that pre-ART, ART, and the current era, what is the life impact? Why I'm mentioning this, that individual benefit of
ARV is unquestionable. But what we are talking here is a public health. And treatment, use of treatment as a prevention, we have to be very, very careful. And unless we use treatment as a public health tool, we would not achieve the treatment goal. And that's where I want to see this slide. The treatment, you know, today there are several countries in Southern Africa, East South Africa, let us say Botswana. Treatment rate, you would see more than 90%. You would see two other countries there where treatment rate is reaching 90%. But the infection has not come down. The 10% people who are outside treatment continue to propagate infection. So who are these people? So my point would be, when you do treatment for public health program, we have to think in a public health fashion and for the community. And that's where reduction of incidence, two-third incidence reduction, is the more important goal for treatment than individual treatment. Now, just to remind you that Thailand that time was the highest prevalence country, and it is today one of the lowest setting because of the AIDS strategy. Now my second point is that even if the goal of ending AIDS and scientific basis is very clear, in India at our current rate we are not going to achieve either new infection target nor the treatment target. I've not done modeling, I've just done simple spreadsheet. Just look at the second top box, which shows what is the current infection of India. It is 2013 data, around 130,000. And then by 2020, it should be reducing 75% of this. So it should come down to somewhere around 35,000. But the red line shows at our current horizontal line of decline where the new infection would be there. So which means we'll miss the target of new infection reduction in India at our current pace of intervention for prevention. Same for the treatment. Look at the right side box first. If I linearly extrapolate without any modeling, extrapolate the Indian number, you would see that currently we are at roughly 1 million by 1st December. We hope that we'll be reaching 1st million patients for ARV. And as you know, 80% of 2 million roughly HIV positive people need treatment for 1.6 million. And by this current rate, in the next 3 years or 4 years, we'll be nowhere near that unless we do things differently. And if I do a scorecard, this was my, in my last job, my global analysis. India is one of the 22 countries which would be high burden countries. And like many other countries, in all three, new infection, ART coverage, and PMTCT, it will get a red color, meaning it will not be able to meet the target. Now, many of you are clinicians here, and for you, I think it's a key issue. Many of you know that tuberculosis program, many way generated from India, the public health program of tuberculosis. But once we see today, we see a static curve. And being many of the best clinicians in the world and public health people, the TB curve in India has not come down. Many of you may not know, TB continues to be the largest cause of mortality between 15 to 45 years of age. Why I'm saying this? I'm saying this that we'll soon, with the rolling out of ARV treatment in private sector and in mass rollout, unless we combine with community-based follow-up, will be reaching the same situation like tuberculosis. You can see that out of 2 million cases, nobody knows the second bar. It's a government data, I've used it. Around 2 million people are tested positive. But only 1.2 million have been enrolled in any kind of care. And nobody knows what is the viral suppression. We have not even rolled out viral suppression. Our global guideline was very clear 2 years back that we need to move away from CD4 to viral load. And then we see that unless we ensure adherence, and I've seen mass rollout program in Africa, people travel 2 days, Q1 full night to get drug, but then there is no follow-up. So the demand generation, demand from the people for ARV would go up very high, but this is high time, unless we link it up with the community workers, the peer educators, the PLHIV groups, to follow them in the community with the for adherence, I don't think we'll be making any dent in ARV treatment, particularly in terms of prevention, and we might enter a tuberculosis situation in AIDS. My next point is, so ending AIDS need, particularly using treatment, needs a different type of approach and different game-changing approach. To show you, you see this is the way the district's maps look through. And you see that 2003, half of the country was still white. And now you see that it has gone back, most of the part is orange to red, you know. And why is this? And Ganga knows that he was part of the first surveillance workshop in the country. We rolled out in 1996, we rolled out 64 sites in the country. Now the sites are 1,000. So why we fail to detect, why need again scientists like Suniti again to work to see new cases? You know, many districts still see new cases, like the way it was done, you know, late 80s. So the surveillance has not worked in terms of early detection of where the infection is and stop it immediately. And you'd also see that the epidemic also has changed, you know. Somewhere it is the south where sex work epidemic has been controlled, and Maharashtra, it's mainly moving to MSM epidemic as the main brunt of the new infection. You see IDU epidemic has come in Punjab, some part of Western India, and then in other place, sex work epidemic is slowly rising. So just a, you know, blanket approach or a one-stroke approach may not work for India. And looking at this, you see there are three epidemics going on. You know, look at the right side of the right box. You see five states infection is coming down. There are five more states where infection is going up. And when we project a good picture of India outside the world, and I'm a part of that too, we never say this, that half of India infection is rising. And unless you do something now, and in spite of the good surveillance system in place, we have failed to control infection, we may not end up in a good situation. It reminds me of, this is the number of sites, and you would see that we are proud of thousands of surveillance sites. India is seen as one of the best practice, but it fails to monitor two things. At the end, we do not know if the drug is there at the local level, you know. Often we see crisis stock out. We see whether the money is there for the NGOs or the civil society. If you think any way AIDS has to end in India, the civil society and the community has to play a very big role in the community, both for treatment and prevention. And without money, many people here know who works on the community. Last 2 years, there was a very erratic funding, and most time funding was not there for the community. So we do all kind of surveillance, but we fail to monitor whether there is drug or even there is money. So without which, people can't deliver. So this work changed my life. And this is the first time I met many of you here. I was working as an epidemiologist in some parts in Manipur, working on a difficult strain of rotavirus. And we suddenly see, because there, those days we could do only Western blot. So we could see suddenly in 2 months' time, from the first case of getting HIV among drug users, we saw 60% drug use. HIV among the drug user. Why I'm mentioning this? That we saw this in 89, say 26 years back, almost 27 years back. But I'm seeing the same thing. I've come back to the country after almost 20 years. I'm seeing the same thing again in Punjab. So what was happening in our surveillance? And nowadays we have PrEP, we have ART, we have rolled out community
surveillance, many things we have. So my point is, we have all the tools, and I'll come to that, we have resources also in place, but we have to be result focused, and we have to change our response from the capital and the, you know, and the state capitals to the hotspots. And that's where you would see that even where you see the 2006 color, when you are coming to 2013, you see orange colors are becoming red. So wherever intervention are happening, targeted intervention in place, the quality is also questionable. So, and no prevention. Prevention is like a vaccine, you know. If you do ARV, it's also like a prevention. You have to cover 80%. You can't achieve measles elimination or polio elimination without covering more than, 80 to 90%, children. Same thing works here. Now, we looked into the fund, you know. We see where the money is going. If you look at the resources, currently India spend around 200 million per year, which in my estimate can give a good coverage for treatment and prevention. But when you look at the where the money is going, you would see that the money is going in the other prevention. We know in Asia, and we have done extensive work, and many of you are stalwarts on this, we have proven that in Asia, epidemic would be only for sex worker, drug user, you know, men who have sex with men and their partners. There is no case of large-scale generalized epidemic. But when I look at the prevention, the 95% of new infection come from so-called key population and their partners, but the prevention money is in the low-risk population. So even for the treatment, the point would remain same. Within treatment, unless we prioritize key population, the main source of infection, we'll see the same problem. I did some modeling for both. This is the data from Kenya and Botswana. And this is the first circle is the population distribution by the risk. The second is who transmitted the last 1,000 infection. I'm not using politically right word here, but I'm saying if you look at the which is the population group where the infection came from versus who received the infection, you see most of it's like this country again, you know, even in South African setting. I see that low-risk population like heterosexual women get it from their husband or from their partners. So they are the recent infected. They need PrEP, they need prevention. But if you want to use ART, you need to target another group who are the key population, sex worker, both casual. Many of you who know African setting would know that the sex worker setting is different. Casual sex and multi-partner sex should be the main intervention point there. To a different group. The point I'm saying is, people often think that if we roll out treatment, we'll achieve ending AIDS, and that's not the case. You have to prioritize. And I see that the resources go up for receiver of new infection, low-risk population, and not for the transmitter. This is the resource gap. You would see that this is a projection from UNAIDS and WHO, what would be resource, almost $2 billion per year, roughly. And So 2 billion would be for every 2 years, you know. So around 800 to 1 billion, and we have only one third of the resources. That's more the reason that we need to prioritize our program. And as you know, the treatment is most powerful prevention today. And no more there is a difference between treatment and prevention. But these are data from China of my own work, and I show that left side is the prevention and right side is the treatment. You see the cascade. And whether you try to do drug user prevention program or you start treatment program, you see there huge loss, more than 80% loss. Why I picked up China? Because China has a mass testing and treatment policy. It also has a mass for the drug user prevention policy. So there also you see such huge cascade in the drop and attrition. And my point is in India, for any prevention, this gap can only be made up by the community. And unless you involve community groups and the organization, we'll see the same problem. Now, in spite of the large global fund grant in this region, the huge international money has come. When I was looking after Asia and Global Fund as a director, my Asia budget was alone on HIV was $2 billion. And how much of these went to the community? Less than 2%. And you see, this is a, many of you who have gone to Patpong, the brothel of, Thailand. This is the Empower's, office. The office has fully, they can't hold any workshop anymore for the sex work. It has changed to the paperwork for Global Fund, you know. So money has transformed the CBOs into paper pusher, and we have not really empowered the CBOs and the communities to take decision about them. And I cannot but stop recollecting our Manipur work. It was as early as 1990, and we saw that only the drug user themselves could reach 80% of the drug user. No other way we could reach the drug user themselves. So don't underestimate the role of the community organization. And then, recent context I just want to highlight. Many of you know that the first time in the history of communicable disease, all the major communicable diseases have been called for elimination. Do not want to control the diseases. We want to eliminate diseases. And it is not a political issue, it's feasible. And the disease which has been picked up are tuberculosis, HIV, malaria, and neglected tropical diseases. Many of you may not know, I also did not know, last one year after coming back, I'm working on leprosy again. There's more than 100,000 new cases of leprosy in India still today. And there is no reason that this disease should exist. And we have committed that this SDG 3.3 will eliminate these diseases. My point is, AIDS no more need to work alone and in isolation. If AIDS is up for ending AIDS, the same the activism, the same use of science, same passion which I see in this room can be used, and these diseases could be worked together for elimination of SDG 3.3 or all communicable diseases. And internationally, many of you have been shaken by this picture. You know, this is a telling picture which shows that the global health flops, you know, when only 5% refugees appear in Europe, the global health, there is no health care for them. Forget even if you don't allow them to enter. So the paradigm which we had from 2002 to 2011, that the global health resources, the resources have stabilized and the resources are coming down. And resources are coming down. So whatever India has to do it of its own money and more useful use of resources. And this will be my 7-point action I will say we need to do. We need to, really, half of India, please believe me, is still not HIV infected. They have not seen the brunt of infection, which some of you have worked in South or Maharashtra. So we need to have early surveillance for early action. Then we need to put prevention as the focus. Don't misunderstand me, not treatment number is the goal. To reach prevention, treatment number has to go up. But if you start treatment number as a goal, then you may end up in low-risk population treatment without any impact on prevention. Key population would remain a priority, and community-based organization, we came out with this idea of treatment 2.0, where it is visualized that first-line drug would be a green pill, a single green pill would be given by a community worker. They need not go to the health center all the time, and a red pill would be second-line drug by a community worker. This has remained a dream. This has not happened. But I have seen community workers can do this. And you know that India is one of the countries collect huge amount of data on surveillance, but none of this data go back. Many of you don't know. Do not go back to the frontline worker. They don't know. This is for the donors. This is for people like us who work in international organization. We say India is doing good or bad, but it never goes back to the community. How many in this village, in this ward or municipality, how many people are not getting treatment? We never give back this data. So this has to change. And lastly, I would say that AIDS cannot sustain by itself. Gilada was just now telling me that people are all moving out from HIV because you cannot, AIDS has a pathfinder program. Unless others see the benefit of this, AIDS would remain in isolation. And that's how I suggest that AIDS, tuberculosis, hepatitis must come together, which are opportunistic infection anyway, and we need to tackle them together. And lastly, India has to bring out its novel approach. Nobody else is going to give the solution. And If we do this, like HIV has made transformational changes, many of you, like Suniti, and it reminds me of her, has worked from the beginning, know that how people change their life, how it changes the life of the community. So if we do ending AIDS well, it will transform the healthcare delivery and change of life of many people who are marginalized and excluded. And thank you very much.
I hope we have.
For giving the late Dr. Suniti Solomon Oration at ASICON 2016 and for his exemplary contributions towards control of HIV/AIDS and communicable diseases in Southeast Asia. ASICON 2016, Mumbai, India, October 7 to 9, 2016.